Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the 13th meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee. Before we begin, a reminder that social distancing measures are in place across Holyrood. Please take care to observe these measures. We have apologies from Natalie Dawn. Colette Stevenson is in attendance as committee substitute. At agenda item one, we have consideration of whether to take agenda items 4 and 5 in private. Item 4 is consideration of the evidence heard on the single-use plastic subordinate legislation. Item 5 is consideration of the committee's work programme. Are we agreed?
Agreed.
That is agreed. Items 4 and 5 will be taken in private. Our first substantive item today is an evidence session on the Environmental Protection Single-Use Plastics Products Scotland Regulations 2021. These regulations are subject to the negative procedure. This means they will come into law unless the Parliament agrees to annul them. Last week, the committee took evidence from the Scottish Government on the subordinate legislation, and afterwards we agreed that we would take evidence from stakeholders. We appreciate these invitations went out at short notice, so we are very grateful for our two guests joining the committee this morning. I welcome to our panel Jim Fox, Associate Director of Public Affairs, Food and Drink Federation Scotland, who is attending in person, and Ian Gilland, Chief Executive, Zero Waste Scotland, who is joining us remotely. Thank you both for joining the committee this morning. I also put on record that we have also written to the Law Society of Scotland seeking their views on the regulations, and we have received short submissions from the Federation of Small Business, David Lonsdale of the Scottish Retail Consortium and Inclusion Scotland. Thank you both to our panel members for joining this morning. Before we begin questions, let me just check if either of you would like to make a short opening statement to the committee, or should we just move straight to questions?
I'm happy to go to questions, Convener.
Great. Okay, well, thank you once again. Let me start with the kind of first question. What do you see as the real life business impact of these regulations in Scotland? And do you think these have been, the impacts have been fully and satisfactorily investigated by the Scottish Government in developing these regulations? And Jim, I'll put that question to you first.
I think in short, yes, I don't think that there will be very much impact at all for Scottish businesses. This has been trailed for a long time. I think most businesses that pay attention to these matters will already be well on their way to ridding themselves from any of the items that you're regulating. I don't see a problem, and I've checked with several businesses before coming here today, and they've anticipated this for quite a long time. It's already enforced in England.
Yep.
It's already enforced in Europe. You know, we don't see a problem.
Okay. Thanks very much, Jim. And Ian, same question to you.
Yeah, I think I'd thank you and good morning. I think I would echo what Jim's saying. I think we're already seeing a shift in businesses around moving away from the products that are under consideration. But obviously, at Zero Waste Scotland, we did support the government through the development of these, the restrictions. We're heavily involved in the consultation, helping them with the consultation, particularly on the stakeholder engagement. And we also supported the development of the business impact assessment as well, which obviously, demonstrated that, I think the figures, I'm sure colleagues have seen that, 95% of the, certainly the plastic products are imported into the UK. So there's very limited impacts on the value chain here in Scotland. And when we looked at polystyrene, EPS, although there is more of that developed in the UK, we spent quite a bit of time investigating what was happening in Scotland, and we really couldn't find any companies in Scotland who were going to be impacted on it. Those that were producing EPS, we're doing it at a much greater scale, not the products that have been mentioned, more around insulation. Even talking to the kind of key stakeholders involved in EPS was a recognition that people were moving away from these products quite quickly.
Thank you both for those responses. Let me bring in the Deputy Convener, Fiona Hislop.
Thank you. This is obviously just a key stage in looking at the regulations. Part of that will be the guidance that the Scottish Government will provide. And really, just from your different perspectives, do you think there's sufficient guidance on the implementation from the Scottish Government in relation to the regulations? Or is there anything additional or additional guidance that you think would be helpful to see the successful implementation of these regulations?
I think we're broadly supportive of the approach. I think it's we welcome the change in the plastic straws thing, the disability issue there, and that was the last remaining hurdle, I think, for industry.
Thank you. And
yeah. Obviously, we're supporting the government with the guidance, and we'll continue to do so. Obviously, in the run up to the implementation in June. Is guidance that will evolve. We will continue to work directly, communicate directly, engage with stakeholders right across the value chain to ensure the guidance is, is reflecting on any consideration or any, considerations that they have. But yeah, absolutely, stuff around the exemptions around straws, etc., needs to be articulated quite clearly to quite a bit, in terms of the hospitality industry, particularly, and some of the other aspects. But we're engaged. I mean, we're obviously continue to engage with all of those people. But we know from other work that we've done, you need to be proactive in making sure that every part of the hospitality industry, every part of the supply chain, all producers actually understand what's happening. So we'll continue to do that on an ongoing basis.
So it might not be just be guidance, but it's awareness as well. So I think part of this is I know it's been a long time coming, but do you both think there's a sufficient awareness? Obviously, big companies will certainly be very cognizant of it, but there's obviously some perhaps smaller outlets or smaller organisations that may need to be alerted to that. So any sense of that? I think everybody knows what's happening, or is there more communication required about this?
I'm not taking any soundings from very small businesses, but certainly medium businesses and large businesses. The large businesses have been aware of European regulation for a long time and are, exposed to the trade association's briefings on that. Medium businesses, I think, fall into two camps, those that are aspiring to be trade association members, and they will be well informed, and others who may not be keeping up with this. I'm not really aware of anybody at that level, so I really couldn't speak about how well they would be informed.
And our colleague from Zero Waste Scotland.
Yeah, I guess we'd always say that we shouldn't get complacent, but I think awareness levels are very high. Obviously, we've been talking about plastics in general for a number of years now, and consumer pressure as well has led to a lot more awareness, front of the house, so to speak, within the supply chain. Is obviously, as I've said, is evolving already. So I think awareness is high. But I think as we get nearer to the implementation date, we need to be more proactively engaging, not just with individual businesses, but through their trade associations and other supply chains. So it's something that we will continue to do.
Thank you, Camino.
Thank you very much, Fiona. Let me bring in Liam Kerr, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. If these regulations come in, a business or indeed a person who manufactures or supplies certain plastics commits a criminal offence with a fine of up to £5,000. Now, the Law Society suggests that pushing this to a criminal law sanction might not be justified or proportionate, and might not be the best way to ensure compliance. They suggest that civil sanctions, which have been used in other similar legislation, might be better. Do either of you, or where relevant, your members take a view on the use of a criminal sanction in these regulations? Ian, first of all.
I mean, to be fair, that's very much out with my area of expertise. Really don't, Zero Waste Scotland have a view on that. That is something that, we would obviously take guidance from both government lawyers and others. We're not part of the regulatory regime. We're about the implementation of the scheme.
going to say the same thing.
Thank you, gents. I rather thought you might say that, or there was certainly a risk that you might say that. You may give a similar response to my follow-up question. The investigation and enforcement of this and this criminal sanction will be done by local authorities. Again, you may not know this, but is there any way of knowing whether local authorities feel sufficiently resourced and indeed able to do full investigation and enforcement? Ian?
Again, I'm not aware of that, you know, any specific resource requirements or capacity. But again, as part of this, you know, we will be, you know, communicating with local authorities, you know, talking to COSLA about, you know, the guidance that, you know, that is available to them as well to carry out any duties that they will have going forward. So I'm not aware of them flagging up any issues at this moment in time.
I will answer a short piece of that. I think that we're generally concerned about the abilities of the authorities to regulate or to administer the regulations as they come. Not particularly these, but there are several now that are coming to the fore on environment. DRS is just one of them, EPR, you got, and the single-use plastics. I think in general, we're very concerned that the authorities that should be trying to protect our interests will not be able to. With the best will in the world, they don't have the resources for that. And we've asked several times during the conversations, during the evidence sessions on DRS, and we were never given a real, you know, we were still left with concerns that, you know, we've got a DRS system which will cost us many tens of millions of pounds, and if fraud kicks in, that will be, you know, multiples of that. There's a big gap between England and Scotland in terms of the implementation of that. We don't see any real move by the authorities to be able to control movements of goods between England and Scotland. I mean, they're already hard pressed to control things like tobacco and drugs and even people at this stage. So, you know, trying to control things like single-use plastics might be a step too far.
Very grateful. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Liam. Jim, just to follow up on that point, because it's a slightly wider point about resource at local government level. What personnel, additional resource do you think is required at local government level to monitor this properly?
Convener, I think there's a problem. I've got no reason to volunteer what I think should be done about it. I'm not an expert in that area. I just know that, you know, we are concerned that we will be exposed to fraud.
Yeah, no, understood. Thank you. Let me bring in Jackie Dunbar.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning. Can I just maybe touch a bit further on what you were saying just now? You were speaking about the implementation of the DRS. Can you maybe expand a bit more in regards to the oxy-degradable plastics and the wet wipes? You know, what do you think the priorities for those should be?
Yeah, I think Ian might be more qualified, but I'll talk about the oxy-degradable. I think that we're very concerned about having controls on the type of plastic that goes into any recycling project, because if we get it wrong, then the impact on the rest of the plastics in that chain will be negative. So if you mix different types of plastics together and one of them is less than the other, then you come out with the lowest common denominator, really.
Okay. Ian, would you like to add anything?
Yeah, just, I mean, obviously, obviously degradable or not included at this moment in time is a complex area. And, you know, Scottish Government are seeking further information on this. I think we need just to remind ourselves that this isn't, you know, the throwaway culture, so reducing demand. So I think we do need to think seriously about, you know, what we can do to bring future restrictions in place for those things as well, if we're going to be consistent with our approach. The other thing, what was the other thing you asked me about?
It was round about the oxy-degradable plastics and the wet wipes.
And wet wipes. So, yeah, as you'll know, so during the consultation, the public consultation, I think 94% of respondents thought that action should be taken on wet wipes as well, although they weren't actually part of the original list. And obviously, I think you heard last week from the Minister as well that the Scottish Government is working, certainly in liaison with the UK governments around what action could be taken on them as well, to bring that forward. So there's considerations on what more could be done to reduce the impact of wet wipes.
Okay, thank you. I have another question, Convener. Will I ask it just now?
Yeah, sure. Go ahead.
Thank you. It's just to ask you both what you think the economic and social opportunities are around the shift away from single-use items, and how can Scottish businesses and communities capitalise on those opportunities? Do you think there's any support, extra support needed? It's maybe a wish question.
I can't answer that. I mean, I'm not an expert in that area, sorry. I mean, if you're talking about single-use plastics particularly, I mean, I can talk more widely about DRS, but not about single-use plastics in terms of economic impact.
Okay. Ian?
So, yes, I mean, as part of the wider circular economy, we've obviously provided evidence in the past around certainly the economic impacts of that in terms of jobs and new business opportunities, particularly around reuse and you know refurbishment of goods, etc. But certainly in reuse, we're seeing seeing a lot more growth at a local level of packaging-free shops, for instance, zero waste shops popping up all over, and obviously we've supported through grants, a number of those initiatives across the rural parts of Scotland, in particular in the islands, to accelerate, that opportunity, not just for dedicated zero waste shops, but actually other shops just to have that type of facility. So I think, and they're obviously increasing demand by consumers, that's meeting increased demand from consumers as well. So absolutely, I think the shift away from, the throwaway culture towards more circular is going to create much more economic opportunity and internal investment and social benefits as well.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks very much, Jackie. Colette Stevenson, please.
Yeah, good morning, and thanks very much for coming along. I know, Jim, yourself, having visited the site in East Kilbride as part of my constituency in Coca-Cola's European Pacific, you did have your challenges in terms of finding a straw, and attaching that on in terms of some of the products that you produce at the East Kilbride plant. But what I was wanting to ask both of you was, in terms of the regulations that are going forward, do you see how, does it create any challenges around procurement, whether that be from the public sector or other businesses? And maybe, Jim, you could draw upon that in terms of what you've managed to do to solve that problem there.
Yeah, taking particular your reference to straws, we use straws. And there is a particular product called Capri Sun where there's a straw on the pack. You may have seen it. And we're at probably our second or even third iteration of trying to get a paper version that works for that straw. We know McDonald's have gone through the same problem. So paper doesn't work as well as plastic, but of course we all recognise that's the direction we've got to go. So we're just about there. We think we've got a solution that works now, but we've had our problems in getting there, but that's pretty much behind us, as for most other people. If you look at some of the other companies involved in this, they've had to sort of change the way they think, but I've not heard anyone at all saying how this would be the wrong direction to go. It's really been about how we do it as opposed to why we're doing it.
Okay, Ian, do you want to come in on that?
Yeah, similarly. I mean, I think all of, you know, with the lead in to these regulations and the discussions that have been ongoing, I guess, around plastics does lead to innovation. And, you know, I think there are opportunities, as Jim said. We are aware that not just in the UK, but across Europe, there's a number of companies now bringing forward products, you know, particularly to meet that challenge around straws, to move away from plastics more substantially. So I think that's to be encouraged, and that's what happens, I guess, when you bring in legislation, that the market innovates. I think in terms of public procurement, or absolutely, you know, there's always an opportunity, you know, ahead of the regulations. And I know I've been working with a number of the public sector agencies over the last couple of years around reducing the impact of plastics within their, you know, states. You know, they've already been making changes. So, you know, but in the run-up to the legislation, there's no need to wait till the summer. I think there'll be an opportunity for further changes to procurement from within, you know, across the whole of the public sector, but also from some of the main suppliers as well.
Can I just touch upon that in the work that you've carried out, Ian, so far with, like, the local authorities and whatnot, in terms of, particularly in procurement, whether there's some sort of clause in there where there should be a trail in terms of end product destination?
Yeah, so there isn't a specific clause, but absolutely, this is the type of conversations that we're now having, or we have been having with not just local authorities, but other parts of the public sector. It's not just, you know, it's not just what the product has been made of, and where it comes from, but what happens at the end of life. And obviously, you don't want it to have an end of life. You want to have something, you need to find things that are repairable, remanufactured, or can be reused again and again. And we're beginning to see those changes within the supply chain as well to support some of those initiatives. But ultimately, yeah, we still, you know, still ask that question of local authorities, you know, to understand what happens to their waste, what happens to the products that they are either using in their own estates, but also collecting from households and businesses. What is happening to them? I think that's an important part, and I think we're all very aware of the impact of our particularly plastics have had in other parts of the world that have been exported. And again, that's, you know, as well as the kind of moral issue that we need to take on board here. You know, again, it comes back to that economic, you know. I've said this quite often, you know, for every one job there isn't just collecting materials for recycling, there's another 8 jobs in the reprocessing, remanufacturing, repurposing of those products back into the supply chain. So if we're really serious about harnessing those economic opportunities for Scotland, we need to think about doing something more constructive with the materials here in Scotland, hence the circular economy.
Okay, thanks. And do you see that, again, Ian, opportunities there to maximise the sort of circular economy benefits, you know, or supporting enterprises innovating more in that sort of kind of area?
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, that is at the heart of the circular economy, is what can we do, how can we design a system so we're not just, you know, as I said, just doing something clever with waste, but we're actually designing a system so we can maximise, you know, reuse of all of the products and materials that we already have. So we're reducing demand, because ultimately, you know, the real pressure on the climate is from our kind of linear economy, but we're taking more and more stuff, producing stuff, manufacturing, and ultimately throwing it away quite often after one use, which is what this discussion is all about.
Okay, thank you.
Can I just add to that?
Absolutely, come on.
You're worried about exporting problem materials. Most of the countries that we would look to export are already moving in the same direction. So these materials wouldn't be welcome there either. I mean, Europe's already moved. I hear now that China is even regulating this. Sorry, I didn't mean that to sound derogatory towards China, but, you know, there are countries all around the world now that are moving in this direction. And, you know, big multinational companies will look at that and decide that they don't, you know, they might as well produce one type of whatever it is than several, and therefore the direction of travel is to eliminate these all over the place. You know, it's not a Scottish problem, it's a global problem.
Well, that's good to know. Thanks, Jim.
Great. OK, thanks, Colette. Mark Ruskell, please.
Thanks. I just wanted to ask you if there's any potential threat from the UK Internal Market Act, or are we going to move towards alignment over regulations across the UK? Are there any industry sectors, industry players who are still holding out for a market for, you know, drink straws or anything
the
else?
Internal Market Bill. But I would say, Mark, that you know, the Court of Public Opinion will probably resolve some of those issues. You know, that any big business or even good medium-sized business would not want to be seen not to be on board with these types of regulations.
Yeah. Ian, have you got anything to add on that?
Yeah, I agree. I mean, obviously, the General Market Bill, again, sorry, out with my scope of expertise. Yeah, any differentiation of standards would definitely have an impact. But I think I echo what Jim says. I think, you know, there's a lot more like consumer pressure, and, you know, even from the big businesses, the big corporates, and their supply chains are really, you know, taking this much more seriously. I don't think, you know, I think we'll see that alignment.
Okay. Thank you, Mark. Monica Lennon, please.
Thank you, convener. What we've heard so far is quite encouraging in the sense that businesses are already very engaged and prepared. We've heard that Scotland isn't a first mover in some of these issues, so we know we can learn from practice elsewhere. I know Zero Waste Scotland have been really involved with disability organisations, including Inclusion Scotland, who have given us a written submission. So we know about the Plastic Straws Advisory Group, so maybe turn to Ian in a second. But Jim, you gave the example of Capri Suns, which I'm sure many of us are familiar with, especially anyone who's involved with small children. Thinking about the targeted exemptions, so for example, if someone, you know, buys a Capri Sun in a cafe or somewhere where they're going to sit in, and they request a straw, the Capri Sun is quite a narrow little straw. So, you know, what is the expectation on different businesses in terms of the kind of range of straws that they might have to have if people do request? Because we understand that from the request system, you know, employees won't be able to ask people why they're asking for the straw, and we want to avoid any stigma. So is this something that businesses have to look at in a lot of detail, or can they just have one kind of plastic straw in the cupboard?
I've got to say we've not looked at it in a lot of detail, but
you might know.
I would volunteer that we are talking about the straw and not the container, so it would be quite easy to decant the contents of the container into a suitable vessel, like a tumbler or a cup, so that a normal size straw could be used. I mean, we've not considered that, but I mean, we've not had any problems up until now, and this regulation has given us the problem that we need to move from plastic to paper. But the disability issue is not something that we have considered in the past, but we will do. You know, I've not known that we've had a discussion on that yet.
Yeah, well, it's absolutely essential that the disability and equality issues are considered. So I know Ian Gulland at Zero Waste Scotland had probably more direct involvement in this. So Ian, interested to hear, you know, what level of guidance will be required, because if someone is requesting a plastic straw because of the target exemption, they don't have to give a big explanation, but they might not have their own cup handy, and they might feel at a disadvantage. So I wonder if you can speak to that, given the close involvement of Zero Waste Scotland in that advisory group.
Yeah, no, thanks. So as well as doing the business impact assessment, we've been heavily involved in the equality impact assessment, even the islands impact assessment and the Fairer Scotland impact assessment. So, you know, we've been quite intensively discussing these things, and obviously, yeah, quite closely with some of the disability groups. about this, so we're well aware of the potential challenges that are coming down, and hopefully the guidance will reflect that. I think, without getting to the absolute detail of every single circumstance, I mean, from our experience, though, this is where we do see a degree of innovation and application from people on the front line, so to speak, and again going back to that point of continually updating the guidance, being out there proactively listening to people, how they're going to some extent solve some of these individual issues that are going to arise potentially, and we'll make them we'll update the guidance as we go forward and look for clear channels to communicate this to other areas that are struggling potentially ahead of the regulations coming in, because what we don't want to do is wait for those situations to arise. And I guess I've just reflecting on other implementation, the carrier bag legislation and others, that's been the course of our engagement, right, talking with people right on the front line, not people within the supply chain, but people potentially in the hospitality industry who are going to have to serve customers and what the what they think would be the challenges on that as we go forward. So, absolutely. We know that these are particular issues that that we're going to have to address, and we're working directly with the groups that you've mentioned.
Thank you, Ian. Yeah, that engagement is very important. Wet wipes have been mentioned already, and I asked the Minister about this last week, and what other items may be covered by future restrictions. I think you quoted a figure of 94% of the public being in favour of a ban on wet wipes, so it looks like the public are way ahead of governments on this issue. From a Zero Waste Scotland perspective, Ian, what more could be done to minimise the use of single-use wet wipes, and when would you think that the government in Scotland could look at this issue again and perhaps add that to the list of restricted items?
So I don't know if I said 94% people wanted a ban. I'd have to check the consultation. Certainly they wanted action on wet wipes, whether it was an out-and-out ban that they said, but certainly they felt that further action on wet wipes would be productive. So I think again, the reason that list is the list that's going forward is that there are already alternatives, readily accessible alternatives to that list. So whilst there are some, there are alternatives to plastic and wet wipes, cellulose layer and stuff like that. There's still some work to understand still what the impact of that is within the wider environment, in terms of degradability, etc. So there's some other things that need to be just worked through in terms of the technical aspects of it. But clearly, it's been highlighted as still a massive issue, particularly around the beach surveys here in Scotland and across the UK. So it's not just a Scottish issue; it's a UK issue. Hence, there's certainly an opportunity to work at UK level if a ban or further restrictions are going to be put in place. So I think certainly I know from discussions with Scottish Government it's something they're keen to pursue, look into at pace. It's something that's obviously on their agenda at this moment in time.
Thank you, and thank you for the clarification.
Thanks very much, Monica. Final question from me. The plastic, single plastic use regulation we're considering this morning is part of a wider series of environment-related regulations that will be coming into force over the coming months and years ahead. I wonder, Jim, if you want to take this opportunity to give your views on what future regulations may have more of an impact on business and which may cause your members some concern.
Thank you, Convener. I welcome that. All the regulations that are coming our way are largely the right things to do, but Markham and Wise said it, not necessarily in the right order. We have we've worked on DRS for a while now, and we think that's the right way to go. We've been supportive of that for 4 or 5 years. we're struggling just to get to that end game at the moment, and I know the minister's considering a delay in that, and we hope that she does give a delay, because you know there are some parts of the industry that are ready to go and some parts of the industry that are not ready to go. On DRS, it can't be delivered in parts, it's got to be the whole. And our best estimate of the right time to go on DRS is September 2023. That still gives industry a problem, because in England and in Wales, they won't be ready until late 2024. And that was the issue on fraud that I alluded to, because over £4 a case, more expensive in Scotland than in England, you will start to see people trying to make money on that. On EPR, again, exactly the right thing to do. We are largely supportive of it. We still can't get governments, and I'm saying governments, probably Westminster, but there is some part of that would be in Edinburgh, who can't say whether DRS is part of an EPR scheme. We've been waiting 2 years, perhaps three, on a VAT ruling from HMRC. So we've got, and this is the thing about getting it in the right order, we've got EPR coming in between Scotland DRS and England DRS, so EPR comes in the middle of that. You know, that's really confusing and will be a problem. We've got single-use plastics in the background. I don't think that actually impacts on any of that. But what does is plastics packaging tax, which comes in next April. Now, to avoid a plastics packaging tax, we need to be able to use recycled content up to 30%. Now, we're already doing that in the business I work for. There are lots of other businesses already doing that. But as you put that pressure on people, more and more people, to use at least 30% recycled material, the right thing to do, but you don't have the material to use because DRS is not up and running, you start to see the disconnect. DRS should be up and running to give the good materials that allows people to move to recycled material content. All of this is all directionally right, but in the right order, the wrong order, sorry. That's how I would sum it up here.
That's very helpful, thank you. And Ian, did you have any thoughts on the same question?
Yeah, I to some degree, I sympathise with what Jim is saying. I guess, we are in a climate emergency and we do need to take action. We're serious about ending our contribution to climate change. We are going to have to tackle, our throwaway society and our waste issues, and we're going to have to do that at pace. And yes, there are things that are being done, quite quickly because of consumer pressure, because of things that are happening at UK level in terms of legislation around producer responsibility that Jim's already mentioned. That we in Scotland are ourselves and the Scottish Government, we're supporting the Scottish Government developing a route map for achieving our own targets by 2025 and looking beyond that in terms of the climate ambitions. So hopefully that gives us an opportunity, certainly in Scotland, to obviously look at what's already happening and in terms of regulation, but to try, as Jim's probably alluding to set out a clearer pathway and how all these things fit together in the sequencing. But I guess it's quite a dynamic space for all the obvious reasons around, this is about climate change, this is about tackling climate change, and we need to take action. And there's, this huge momentum, certainly in the public, that we need to tackle some of these issues, and we need to do them quickly.
Okay, thank you very much. That wider perspective is actually very helpful. Appreciate it, because it will help guide the committee in the months ahead in terms of when we begin to look or continue to look at some of those issues. I think that brings us to the end of the questions we have in this session. Thank you once again, Jim and Ian, for joining us, for joining this session. Enjoy the rest of your day. That brings us to the end of this public session. We will suspend the meeting and rejoin the session after this change of agenda item. Thank you. Welcome back. Agenda item three is consideration of a negative instrument, the Water Environment Controlled Activities Scotland Amendment Regulations 2021. I refer members to paper number three. The instrument is laid under the negative procedure, which means that its provisions will come into force unless the Parliament agrees to a motion to annul it. No motions to annul have been laid. The Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee considered this instrument on the 23rd of November and determined that it did not need to draw the attention of Parliament to the instrument on any grounds within its remit. Do members have any comments on this instrument? Mark Ruskell.
Thanks, Convener. Very much welcome the sort of broad intention of this instrument, I think, particularly given COP26 and the commitments that were made around methane reduction, but also the need to improve the ecological condition of our freshwater resources as well. I suppose my slight concern with this amendment, with this instrument, is just around where the cut-off point has been chosen for transitional arrangements. So, you know, for the larger farms, they're going to have to move really quickly into, you know, dealing with slurry in a more responsible way. But for the smaller farms, there'll be a delay there. I think a transitional period of up to 5 years with these regulations not really taking effect until 2027. I mean, that leaves us just 3 years before we're meant to be meeting that 30% methane target. So I suppose, you know, what we have before us is before us. I don't object to it, but I'd like to find out more information from the Scottish Government about where they drew the line in terms of, you know, with the smaller farms allowing them to adapt over a much longer timescale. And just some more information on that, I think, would be useful in terms of understanding Scottish Government's thinking on that and perhaps where some of the kind of lobbying has come from, you know, trade bodies and others.
Okay, thanks very much, Mark. Yeah, that seems a sensible suggestion to me. Does any member want to add to that? Okay, are we agreed that the committee will write to the Scottish Government on those terms? Excellent. Okay, great. Apart from that, I invite the committee to agree that it does not wish to make any further recommendations in relation to this instrument. Are we agreed?
Agreed.
We are agreed. Thank you very much. I now close the public part of the committee meeting. Thank you.